Nomen omen. Il tuo nome è il tuo destino. Così si dice. Non so ancora se crederci. In molti sostengono che si tratti solo di una coincidenza. Dicono, cioè, che la vita sia caos puro. Come un corso d'acqua, un fiume che dalla sorgente scorre fra deserti e vallate rigogliose. In superficie, come nel sottosuolo, a volte rompe gli argini, trascina con sé ciò che trova di contro. Credo che ogni fiume abbia il suo odore, il suo percorso, la sua musica, finanche il suo proprio colore. Il colore di questo fiume è il blues. La sorgente bizantina è manifesta nella pelle ambrata e nella chioma corvina. È una sorgente astratta, soprannaturale, incisa nello sguardo errante, pura brama di muoversi. Lidi spumosi e sabbiosi, cime monumentali. Da lì scorre, fluisce verso l'alto finché calpesta humus nuovo, terra etrusca. In principio il fluire è lento. Un vascello appena fuori rada, inala i primi respiri melodici, prende forma. Forma ondosa di chitarra. Le cime di bordo, corde vibranti, blues bark, soul spoilers, elastico, si gonfia. La brezza del genio acerbo gli solletica le dita, ha un sentire fresco e brioso e con occhi nuovi sovverte la meta. Il fiume si ingrossa, progetta l'avventura e l'avventura inizia a indirizzare fiume.
Yeah, I think because Marco and I started playing together with Mark Todorici. I think I sat in with him because Marco came said come see my band. And then Jeff was playing sax, and then I sat in. And I think it might have been a thing where Jeff was busy with other gigs or something too. I can't remember. It's, you know, only 8 years ago. But somehow I started playing with Marco full time. I moved to L.A. after spending 10 years as a professional musician in Miami. And I remember one thing I was worried about when I moved out of town is you worry about losing your family, your musician family. You know, because you know that you have your scene and stuff like that. And I remember after moving to LA and being here for a little bit of time, I was like, wow, man, I didn't miss a beat. I just stepped into a great bunch of people and immediately came across my crowd. And Marco was a big part of that. You know, he was a big part of my scene and the scene, you know, that we have here in town. And the people that, you know, you're happy to see on gigs and happy to spend time with outside of your work. All I know is that you know, I moved into town around 2000, so my time with Marco really wasn't a long time, which is awful, because we got pretty tight. And he was really instrumental in getting me involved in the scene. You know, I've been very fortunate to play with, like, a lot of the people that I was fans of before I moved to L.A., and a lot of the heavies in the blues scene, and a lot of it has to do with Marco. Marco, you know, Marco introduced me, you know, to Rick Holmstrom. He introduced me to Kid Ramos, who took me over there. I mean, he and I ended up playing and working with all these guys a lot. And it was all because of Marco. Marco's the one who grabbed me out and said, hey, we're going to go hang out here. Ron, we're going to hang out here. You know, let's go meet over here and play. You know, I met, you know, Marco over at some club over in Santa Monica the first night that I, you know, met some other guys like Eddie Beatos and James Infeld.
Marco played in my band for a while. He was on my record, The Toughest Girl Alive. It was the only record I made for Rounder. And he plays two songs, I think, on The Toughest Girl Alive. Because he had just joined my band at that time. So I didn't have, I had other guitar players on it also as guests. And so Marco was new. But I heard about him because he was playing with Janova Magnus, and I think he had just finished playing with Janova. I don't know why, but I was looking for someone, and so I got him. I think Jeff Ross told me about him. Jeff Ross is a great guitar player also, and told me about Marco. So I tried him out, and he was really good, and I liked him a lot. He was still learning how to solo and stuff like that. He wasn't really confident yet. But he got better as we played together, and it was worth it to work with him because he was really special and had a good energy about him.
Così, come un Orfeo emerso, l'urgenza. Figlia dell'insoddisfazione, sorella dell'ansia di crescere, di ampliarsi, di apprendere. Il viaggio è adesso, inizia qui. Le Americhe, così si chiamavano un tempo. Dunque le onde di fiume si intrecciano, si confondono, ruggiscono di una voce dissonante, quasi stonata. È la voce dei demoni blu, quella che sente. Di più. Sapere di più. Imparare di più.
Svegliati, attraversa i campi illuminati dalla luna e cerca l'albero d'oro della conoscenza.
Si allontana sempre più da casa, insegue le proprie passioni, sogni. Bagna la città indipendente con le sue acque di musica. Una chitarra al collo e la giusta pendenza a ovest, oltre oceano, sono sufficienti a condurlo. Memphis, St. Louis, New Orleans.
Com'è strano essere lontani da casa, quando la distanza è un intero continente e non sai neanche più dove sia la casa tua. E la casa che ti resta è quella che hai in testa.
New Orleans. Ecco le acque azzurre del golfo, sorvolate da piume di ferro, blu gessate, pentagrammi distorti, denti affilati. To, il gabbiano Junior Watson, e lo insegue quel potente aviatore. Frattanto beccheggia il fiume, gira, garrulo, frignola e singhiozza, saltella, affonda, si rialza e si trasforma, muta colore, i mille del jazz, la notte del blues. Sfringuella il fiume, incide gli argini bianchi con cranio di plettro. Il fiume che figlia foni freschi e fatati. Esland e sia.
I love to laugh with Marco. I love to laugh with him. He was a really funny guy. I wanted to tell you a story about the one time he was playing with Linwood Slim. And Linwood is a harmonica player and singer. Also plays a little bit of flute, but he's not so famous for his flute. Let's just put it like that. All the different musicians would complain about Linwood. Oh, God, I hope he doesn't play the flute. So Marco was, I hate this fucking flute. Every time I play with Linwood, he plays this fucking flute. And so apparently at one of the gigs, Linwood started looking around on the stage for his flute and he couldn't find it. He starts swearing, where's my flute? Marco's over there on the guitar. And he took the flute on the break and he put it behind the toilet in the bathroom at the club, so that Linwood or nobody else could find it. And then at the end of the gig, he took it from back behind the toilet and put it back over there, and Linwood found it. And it was just, that was the kind of person Marco was. He was a very funny guy.
I remember doing a rehearsal at his house and then having to go straight to the gig. And he was like talking, we were all hanging out in the front. And then he comes running back to say something, and he's in just his underpants, you know what I mean? And I'm like, hey, whoa, what's going on here? We're pulling some Italian shit around here. What are you doing that? I was like, I'm American. We don't do that shit. He's like, oh, come on. Yeah, I'm in my underpants. What's wrong with that? He was laughing the whole time. Always laughing with him. But the story is when me and him finished a gig with Torch. I can't remember where that was at. And I was sitting in the back seat, and he was in the front with Mark, and he was just cursing Mark out the whole time. Like, what the hell's the matter with you? What's wrong with you? Like, blah, 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 just bitching at him the whole time. I was like, oh, God.
And this next tune, I want to send out to a very, very good friend of mine who used to be a part of the Hollywood combo. He's gone on to somewhere better now. He used to always wanted to play this song. So Marco, my friend, this one's for you. Whoa, whoa.
considered Marco like a brother, you know, because we could talk about anything. And also, you know, brothers, they have a lot of love for each other, but sometimes they, you know what I'm saying? So we did that too. We would give each other a hard time sometimes, you know. So Marco could do that. He could bust my balls like the best of them, you know. And I busted his balls too. He was a good friend, loyal, very loyal friend. He loved to appreciate the good food and good wine and beautiful women, and we would often get together to talk about, like, if we would get together and talk about music or whatever, but then we could sit and have some wine and have a pizza or maybe go to a restaurant, and he appreciated just the little things in life. He really appreciated the little things in life, the details.
La purezza della strada. La riga bianca nel mezzo si srotolava e si stringeva alla ruota anteriore sinistra come se fosse stata incollata la gomma. Dai, 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 dacci dentro, amico, dacci dentro.
Via, veloce, a ve le spiegate. Galoppa, cavalca le onde, le creste si spezzano, si scontrano e la spuma si mescola. Ride, e come se ride. Occhi strizzati di mandorla nera, accelera, pizzica, saltella e slitta su corde di sabbia, palette di roccia. Berretti e giubbotti di pelle, occhiali da sole, nudi i piedi su rotaie di birra e prosceni di pietra cocente, vola e riposa sul suo battipenna.
La strada è vita, c'è sempre qualcosa di più un po' più in là, non finisce mai. A quel tempo danzavano per le strade come pazzi e io li seguivo a fatica, come ho fatto tutta la vita, con le persone che mi interessano. Perché le uniche persone che esistono per me sono i pazzi. I pazzi di voglia di vivere, di parole, di salvezza, i pazzi del tutto e subito. Quelli che non sbadigliano mai e non dicono mai banalità, ma bruciano, bruciano, bruciano come favolosi fuochi d'artificio gialli che esplodono simili a ragni sopra le stelle e nel mezzo si vede scoppiare la luce azzurra e tutti fanno oh!
And I shambled after as usual, as I've been doing all my life, after people that interest me. Because the only people that interest me are the mad ones. The ones that are mad to live, mad to talk, desirous of everything at the same time. The ones that never yawn or say a commonplace thing, but burn, burn, burn like Roman candles across the night. Exploding like spiders across the stars. And in the middle you see the blue center light pop, and everybody goes, ah.
Well, I mean, he was a hell of a good guitar player. He was a hell of a good swinging blues guitarist. And there was no doubt in my mind that he would have become a great jazz player. He was already good at that. And I don't know, he had a great tone and he knew how to use it. You know, a good tone is something to start with, but he could actually say something good with it. You know, I think a lot of the guitar players around town liked the way he played. And, you know, it was kind of a freestyle of playing with a lot of improvisation. And it was kind of funny, you know, he would play these great solos. And then at the end of it, he would look over at me and look kind of embarrassed and sheepish, like he didn't think he played something good. But in reality, he was playing something really nice.
Playing the melody and just going crazy, just playing, you know. So there was a lot of, quite a bit of improvisation, quite a big one. And it was quite freeing, because a lot of us were doing straight up blues gigs, you know what I mean? We were doing straight up stuff, like with, like Marco with Candy Cane, and myself with Mark and the Hollywood Combo. What was I playing with around? I was playing with Deke Dickerson right before that, too. But Marco's thing was really, you know, was all about blowing, you know, interaction, playing, play the head, solo like crazy. So it was a fun gig, it was a blast, had a great time. It was a perfect venue for the band, you know. It was like really dark in there, and it was like a little martini bar. It was a pretty small venue, and it was just perfect for the music. And we did quite well with people coming out, so, you know. So it was always a rocking night, and a lot of people came by to sit in, and.
Marco was a man who he followed his passions. He was a passionate person on and off the stage, but it really came through in his playing. If Marco was happy or sad or angry or something, you heard it in his music. He played like, not even that there was no tomorrow, he played like this song might be his last song. Every song like this, you could hear it in his playing. He had a sense of urgency, he had a sense of, this is me, this is me coming through my guitar. I want to show you Marco. And when somebody plays like that, it makes you listen. And what's incredible about Marco was he came here not knowing anyone. And he was playing with all of his heroes. He was learning right at their side from Junior Watson, Rick Holmstrom, all of these people that were his heroes. He was learning right alongside them. And he was achieving his dream. And he was becoming just as good as his heroes. He really did. He was following his dream, but I think he also achieved his dream as well.
I think he had he was very influenced by Junior Watson, and he and Junior were good friends, and Junior was, I think, the most influential guitar player for Marco, because Junior was not only his hero, but also his friend, so that made a lot of difference, I think, in Marco's life. I think Marco was really played a lot like Junior, and also he seemed to have that electric style, sort of, maybe like a Freddie King or Albert Collins. Yeah, I think he had that style.
So one more time, a warm welcome for Junior Watson. You know, there's a couple friends I just met here tonight from Italy. And I have a young student I had years ago that was just a great friend of mine, and he died. So this song is going to be dedicated to Marco Fumi.
Marco. Hey, come on. Two. I want. Two. Three.
Thank you.
suppose the thing we were trying to do, all being blues players who were trying to come to come into jazz, you know, I think especially for Marco, you know, he was used to grooves that went like this. So his playing, when he did his solos, it had that kind of shuffling groove to it. And what I was trying to do was to get him to come more to the swing groove, which is a bouncing four. Was you know the bluesy side of jazz and the jazzy side of blues, I guess.
Well, that's what he calls music, you know, or the bluesy side of jazz, the jazzy side of blues, you know. And I mean, he'd been playing a lot of hardcore blues. You know what I mean? He'd been playing with Kenny. It was just a blues band, and a lot of stuff he'd been playing around town was strictly blues, and he was trying to push it that way. So he was hitting jazz from a bluesy side, but then it was also, you know, still playing his stuff, blues, on the jazzy side. You know, I mean, he was introducing a lot of those jazz things in jazz. He was introducing a lot of jazz vocabulary in what he was playing, but I mean, it was, you know, it still had those blues shuffle beats, but it was, you know, real extended soloing. It wasn't, you know, you're just three choruses and done. I mean, you were blowing for a long time. You know, those tunes were, they weren't like 2 minute songs, you know what I mean? We were playing, you know? So I think that's what it was. It was, you know, a lot of blues forms, Celtic blues, you know, a lot of blowing, which made it jazz. Well, you know, a lot of the rhythms and stuff were coming from the blues tradition, you know? But we were playing like blues heads from the jazz tradition. It was like, you know, it was really straddling the two things. But I think he was moving more to the jazz yourself.
That's a good description of Marco, because he loved the blues, he loved hard rocking, really kind of raunchy, low down blues, but also loved the jazz and the swingy side of things. And that's a perfect way to describe how Marco played, because he incorporated both of those things together. That's also what he used as the description of the lo-fis, his band. The bluesy side of jazz, the jazzy side of blues. So it was perfect for him.
Il fiume è la strada, asfalto nero di luce e di ombre. Diritta e curva risale e discende mentre San Diego gli ruba un pezzo di cuore pulsante, lo annusa, lo culla, lo abbraccia. Chi brinda è felice, chi brinda è perduto. Il frutto dell'arte cade dall'albero del viaggio intorno al mondo, a caccia del blu del cielo e delle vette azzurre su cui spicca il fiore azzurro dell'equilibrio. Il viaggio è intrecciato di note blues, tanto grevi da tirar giù le pareti dello spirito. Viaggiare e andare oltre, strisciarsi dentro e accelerare per fluire, grattare, ridere, splendere, frantumando le ganasce che premono contro copertoni di labbra che addentano e castrano il motore pensante. Il manico vibra e indica lo sbocco di fiume nell'ovest lontano dove l'aspetta l'unione smarrita d'un tempo. Il viaggio continua e la strada svanisce sotto mozzi rivestiti di gomma. E di lontano, vanitosa, si osserva riflessa nelle orecchie di vetro a specchio della carrozza di ferro.
Che cos'è quella sensazione quando ci si allontana dalle persone e loro restano sulla pianura finché le si vede appena come macchioline che si disperdono? È il mondo troppo vasto che ci sovrasta, ma noi puntiamo avanti, verso la prossima pazzesca avventura sotto i cieli.
Tirare col viaggio, mai spezzare il sorriso. Flash, gli amici, l'arrosto, sorriso. Musica, vino saltare, sorriso. E intanto pensare, ignorare le nubi accalcate nel buio serale, sorriso. Viaggiare è dar fuoco a una catasta di vita, di spiriti felici e inquieti. e il suo fuoco brucia sui liti pacifici. Vecchio amico, il mare, ricordo lontano d'infanzia. Lo scorge e corre veloce il fiume, pieno d'estasi viene dentro al Pacifico che lo perde fra maniche liquide di vesti spumose. La baia è calma, beata del sorriso splendente e odoroso d'arancio del Golden Gate Bridge. Tutt'uno col mare, non più vascello. Cargo, petroliera, rompighiaccio, avanza sicuro fiume, diretto all'ultima meta. La notte rifulge, galassia di neon, e non si sente più solo. Uomo di viaggio ama il mondo, e il mondo errante lo ama.
A me piacciono troppe cose, Mark Tortorici, e mi ritrovo sempre confuso e impergolato a correre da una stella cadente all'altra, Ron Zubla, finché non precipito.
La musica scorre riempiendo la vita. Della vita fiume suona le note.
I just think he really could have accomplished wonderful things as a player. He could have really been made a mark, certainly in the Los Angeles blues scene. I remember when we were in Rossano, I think they gave Alex Schultz Marco's gold guitar or something like that, or to play. He played the gold guitar, and that was really sad. Man, geez. That was a really sad moment to see him playing the guitar. Marco should have been there playing, you know. That whole thing was like a dream, to be there and to be around his people, and to, we got to go to the cemetery where he was buried and visit him. We shouldn't have been visiting such a talented, young, handsome guy in a fucking cemetery. Your family is really an incredible, different kind of person, and it's just, I think, a big shame.
But when I listen to Marco playing on the stage with me, that, it was perfect for me. And so that's why I miss him so much, musically, because he played what I heard in my head, you know, and he played it with passion, and it was a amazing that way musically, you know. That's why we had a brotherhood musically,
you know. When you're in your 20s, you're, you know, I mean, that's young, you know, that's young. You don't hit your stride as a musician till you get in your 30s. I think I definitely didn't, you know. I mean, I felt myself, you know, getting to where I was going, you know, in my late 20s. But it really starts happening in your early 30s, you know. I mean, you got to put in the time. He didn't put in the time yet, you know. I'm not saying that he didn't practice. That's not what I mean. I mean, he didn't put in the time on the planet yet to where his playing was really there. He wasn't there yet.
There was a place we were talking about playing in Fullerton. I forget what the name of it was, but you know, they had the idea that we could get a gig here and start to develop the trio and the music we were playing, but unfortunately it didn't happen.
Dicono che il nome è destino, ma non ho conosciuto chi pensa ad arginare la forza creatrice di un fiume. Suonare a malacqua, dicevano i vecchi, e quella davvero pioveva nel fiume. Trio Loco, Lo-Fi's e Hollywood Combo al King King, tutte amate, tutte fottute e buttate all'aria, braccia e gambe molli, neppure Candy Kane si salva, lei, la più difficile in vita. Chi brinda è felice. Chi brinda è alla fine. Marco, credo che ogni fiume abbia un odore, un percorso che è un viaggio, un bagaglio di musica, un fiore da cogliere, e un proprio colore che è melodia. Blues.
Ron on the tenor sax, and also a good friend of mine over here, on the yellow stratotone, Mr. Marco Fiume, all the way from Bologna, Italy, to play his song for you.
Marco's mom.